Welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop. Today's episode is sponsored in part by Highland Woodworking. Visit their website at highlandwoodworking.com. And also by Lee Valley and Veritas. Visit their website at leevalley.com. Hey everybody, welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop podcast. So for today's episode, we're getting started on a brand new build project. And in fact, it's going to be this full length mirror that we have here. Now this is a really neat project. Be quite honest with you, it went pretty quickly. In fact, typically as it is for the show, if it wasn't for the fact that we would stop and do some videoing of this, it would go a lot faster. In fact, this could easily be a project you could accomplish in a single day, if not an entire weekend, including the actual finishing. Now, as you can see, we made this project completely from cherry. And this has been some cherry that's been sitting around in my shop for quite a while now. In fact, I'm going to say it's probably about 4 to 5 years old at the most. So it's kind of already started to take on that nice dark patina that cherry tends to have. When we cut into it, you may even notice, if we can kind of get some of the video frames the right way, you'll see it has like that nice like kind of pink look when we first expose the fresh edge. But immediately, once it gets a little oxidated, it starts again to take on that aged look. And since it's been down in the basement, it actually hasn't been exposed to very much light. So once we get it up in position, which is going to be up in our bedroom, this is going to be one of those things where the sunlight is going to start to really darken it up. And if I remember, or maybe some of you remind me later on down the road, we'll take some pictures of it to show how much it has actually aged. Now, of course, there are some ways to age it yourself. You could apply a stain to it to kind of give it that darker look. Boiled linseed oil tends to be something, usually some sort of oil. Boiled linseed oil for sure is one of them that will help to darken it. There's even talk about the fact that you can just take the wood outside and expose it to the sun right away and give it like more or less a suntan, and that will also help to speed up the aging process. But with this one, I like it where it is at the moment, and we'll just let it slowly, gradually darken over the years. So anyways though, another thing about the mirror is when it comes to the design. My original intent when I did this was to more or less kind of go for a green and green style. In other words, where the joinery comes together at the top and the bottom, where the rails and stiles meet, I originally had planned on maybe like doing some of those like pillow effects in it, you know, where it kind of raises up a little bit. As you can also see in the pictures, we have some walnut plugs at the joints itself, and these are not just decorative, they're completely functional. They're helping to tie in the mortise and tenon joinery that we did. But again, if I was to go with the green and green as I had originally intended to do, I probably would have, rather than using walnut, I maybe would have used something more like ebony, or I would have ebonized the walnut. And also I would have had them be a little bit more raised and possibly squared off, almost like a pyramid type shape. But instead what I ended up doing was, and we'll talk about this in just a second, why I decided to end up doing this, I went with the form that we have right now. And to be quite honest with you, I think the form we have right now matches more of, if we have a style in the Vanderlust household, this matches it just that much more. And more importantly, once I gave it to my wife, because that's who it was intended for, Samantha absolutely loved it. In fact, when we're done doing the video, we're going to end up hanging it in our bedroom so that we can start using it right away. Again, it's a really quick and easy project to do. So rather than talking about all these different things, let's go ahead and get right into the project itself. And the first place we need to do is we've got to head over to the table saw, because we need to rip the pieces to their width, and then we need to actually cross cut them. So let's head over there next. So over here at the table saw, the first thing we need to do is to rip and then cross cut the four pieces that are going to make up the two rails and the two stiles. Now, before we get to the footage of that, one thing I want to talk about is this is some of that cherry that I ended up using. In fact, this is a cutoff from the exact board that we used for this particular project. One thing, we'll try and get them maybe zoom in a little bit on this, but this board obviously has a lot of the heartwood here, that's the darker wood, and then we have the sapwood. As I've always talked about in the past, one thing I like to do when it comes to building my project is I'm one person that I enjoy nice grain, I enjoy really good figured grain, but I also am not the type of person that will really stress a lot over if the grains really, really, really match up. I mean, when I have a white panel, I like them to match up, but it's not something that's going to like destroy my project if they're off just a little bit. In this situation, just because the pieces are, they need to be kind of uniform when it comes down to it. I wanted to match them up the best I could, so that's why I used a wider board like this. In fact, what I ended up doing is, and we have the picture right now, I have one long board, which is going to make up the styles, and I have one shorter board, and they are obviously much wider than we really need. And the main purpose for that is that by having that little extra width, I could play around with where the grain patterns were that would match up the most for those particular pieces. And the nice thing is also with this particular board, like I said, there was the sapwood, and by having the wider, I could kind of work around where there was some of that sapwood, so when it darkens over age, it gets that nice patina. The sapwood is the one part that for sure will not darken. It will actually kind of stay light, and then the rest of it will get really, really dark. And that's not what I want in this particular project. I actually did kind of want to have be a little bit more uniform than you would normally get from one of my projects. So anyways, though, so that's, we ended up using this wider board, and we got the pieces that we're going to start with. So the first thing we need to do is let's go ahead and rip the pieces down. We set up our rip fence. We're going to start with the long pieces. One thing, many of you always comment on this, you don't see any type of support on the back end. I actually do have roller stands that stand right back there, catch the pieces it's going through, because the last thing I want to worry about is once I get through the blade, having to catch it before it falls off. Rip the first two pieces for the styles, the long pieces. Then we came back, and this is the part that kind of destroyed the idea of going with a green and green style mirror. In fact, this is the part where what I needed to do was move the fence over a little bit further so that I could get a wider rail, which would accommodate for those clouds that I was talking about that really give you the idea that this is a green and green inspired piece. But unfortunately, as I was cutting, and this happens quite a bit, I did move the fence over. So the rails, and as we can see in this picture, we have the four pieces. The rails are exactly the same width as the styles. So that was one of those, the second it happened, I didn't really register at first, but several minutes later, once the cutting was all done, it was like, oh, you gotta be kidding me. So we ended up going back to the drawing table and came up with the pattern that we have, or the design we have right now. All right, so now that the ripping is done, we need to do some cross cutting. And I'm gonna do mine here at the table saw. In fact, I prefer to do as much of my cross cutting as possible here at the table saw. I get really decent results with my miter gauge. And one thing I do like is I have this backer board on here. Now, there are of course a whole bunch of other aftermarket miter gauges, and eventually I probably will upgrade to one of those, but this right now works nice for me. The beauty of having this little backer board on here is the fact that, one, it kind of extends the length of the miter gauge face so that I get more support on, well, obviously short pieces, but also long pieces. Two, it helps to stop any blowout on the back end because of the fact that, you know, this acts kind of like as a zero clearance plate for me. And then three, I already have these kerf cuts in here, and this gives me something to register for my lines so I know where the cut is going to occur and I don't have to try and guess around it. This really helps to kind of speed things up. Anyways, what we need to do now is to cut our rails and styles to length. And the first thing I'm going to do is I want to establish the first end that's so that it's nice and square. And I'm just going to use this as a quick example, then I'll show you the footage. When I go to do this part, one thing I want to do is typically I want to have one end that obviously I like the grain pattern, I like the color, and then usually at the other end is something that not so much, or I just really don't care if that part kind of gets cut off. So I find my favorite end. I will then use that for my first cut. And as you can see in the footage, that's exactly what we're doing. We're cutting that little portion to get just that first end. Be very careful though, because, and I've done this in the past, you might get a little lazy about how much material you can take off. I try to take off a minimum amount so that I don't suddenly discover that actually I took off way too much. So just kind of keep that in mind when you strike that first line and you make that first cross cut. So we've done that with the two styles. We'll do that now with the two rails. Once we have those cut, what we need to do next is to flip the board end for end, and we'll then make the final cut to the length that we want. So what we'll do is just take the board, and we have the one edge that was up against the miter fence. We're just gonna keep that one, and we'll just flip it over this way. The nice thing with this is it will guarantee that the edges the two ends will be square off of the same face, and this gives you something that further down the road will really help when it comes to assembly. So we do that, and then now we come in, I strike a line for where I want the total length of this. I use, again, this curve right here as my reference for where to line up that mark, and I make my cuts. It really couldn't be any easier than that. In fact, sometimes it's almost too easy, or it seems scary easy, but in fact, if I just kind of stick to these basic principles, I get really nice results from it. So now that we have our pieces cut to the right width, we have them cut to the right length, it's time to head back over to the bench, and this time we're gonna start laying out the lines for our mortise and tenon joinery. We set our marking gauge, and the first thing I ended up doing was marking for the tenon, and I start at the end, and I end up coming back to about the approximate depth that I wanted. In this situation, I wanted a tenon that was at the minimum 1 inch deep, so we go ahead and we'll mark for the tenon on one side, and then we'll flip it. We'll do it on the other face, and we'll get those lines established, and then we'll flip the board over, and we'll do it on the exact opposite side. Once we have them marked on the sides, I'm gonna go ahead and do it on the end. So I just kind of hold the board up. Sometimes this gets a little tricky. You wanna watch yourself so you don't get cut. And I just make those marks. Now, here's where I actually do it on the shoulders. And I'm marking for the depth of the tenon. And I'm gonna go ahead and mark the shoulders. Like I said, normally this is something that I do first before I ever begin any of the other layouts. Now in this next step, what I'm doing is I plan on cutting these mortise and tenon joints completely by hand. In fact, I'm gonna end up using my carcass saw and my tenon saw for this whole thing. So what I wanna do is I wanna make sure that my shoulders are as crisp and clean as possible. Typically, you might just start cutting right into it and maybe stay a little shy of the line and then coming back in with your shoulder plane and cleaning to the line. But what I'm doing right now, it adds a little time to the technique, but it will end up giving me a really, really crisp shoulder line. So I'm just taking my chisel, staying a little shy of the line itself, and I'm cutting more or less what amounts to being a slight V groove. And as you can see, I get that first portion done where I'm removing a lot of the waste, and then now I'm coming back in and I'm gonna par right up to the line. In fact, well, what I end up doing is staying still just a smidgen shy. In fact, what I'm really trying to do is to cut that line in half. And so we get that material out of the way the best we can. And then in a second here, we're gonna flip it over, start the second side. But when we get the whole thing done, this is what our line will end up looking like. And this really gives us a nice registration to end up putting the saw into. Now, I don't have a bench hook to work off of, so all I do is I take a couple of bench pups, I turn those, and this will help to wedge the piece in place. So as I'm cutting, and since it's a Western style saw, I'm gonna be pushing away from me. I go ahead and get the saw ready, and I can drop it right into that notch. And again, see how taking that little extra time is gonna give me a nice reference. And what will end up happening is even if my hand gets a little shaky with the saw, I'll still have the exact line that I want and very little cleanup work that I'll have to do. So I drop the saw in and I start cutting, and I'll take it down to the depth that I need for the tenon. It just takes a few passes. We get the first one, and then of course we're gonna flip it over and we're gonna do the same thing on the opposite side. Now this next step is very similar to what we did to establish that shoulder line. And again, what we're gonna do is come in with our chisel and we're gonna create more or less, I guess you could kind of call it like a little bird's mouth. And what this will do is give us that reference that we can drop our tenon saw into, get our cut started, and this will help to establish a nice straight curve. It takes a little practice, but in the end, again, it adds a little bit of time, but the result is totally worth it. So as you can see in the video, what I ended up doing was I took my chisel and I started to create that little V groove that we wanted. And I'll do this on both sides, on both ends of the the tenon so that I have something to reference from both sides, because as we start cutting, what I end up doing is I start on a slight angle, as you can see. I begin my cut, and the first thing I want to do is, as I'm establishing the kerf, I start coming down almost to the complete depth that I want the tenon, and then I start cutting further along into the length of the kerf. Now, my tenon cutting here is a little off in the sense that I need to practice it much more, but I was really happy with the results here. So I made that first cut. I'm almost completely across the whole entire width, and then now I'm going to come back in, and again, this is where having that little V groove, that little bird's mouth kind of a cut, helps to get the tenon saw in place. I can drop it down into the established kerf, saw a little more, and then as you can see, I'm getting the piece, it's almost 90 degrees to the vise, and now I'm gonna start sawing through the material in the middle. This is all I need to do, because I already have the shoulder kerf set, so I'm just gonna keep cutting down, removing the material in the middle until the cheek pops off, as you can see there. And of course, I saw a little bit extra in there, and I thought I could clean it up with my saw, but really, the best thing to do is to use our chisels. So we're going to repeat this process on the opposite side. And in fact, man, I only wish I could saw as fast as what you're going to see here. But once again, because we have that V groove in there, we're going to go ahead, drop it in, and get started. Now, as I mentioned, there was a little bit of waste that kind of hung up from the tenon saws that was coming down to meet the established shoulder cut that we had. And rather than messing around with the saw, it's much easier to come in with a chisel and just kind of remove that waste. The main thing here is to stay away from the face itself, where you already have the shoulder set up. It's one thing if you remove more material inside there, it's not as big of a deal, but you really don't want to mess too much with your actual shoulder align. Now, what we're going to do here is we're going to use our router plane to clean up the cheeks themselves. There's some nice rough marks left by the tenon saw, and if anything, actually, I didn't go completely to the line, so by using the router plane, we're going to end up cleaning up the cheeks so that they're, number one, nice and parallel with each other, but also, once we get the router plane set up in the depth we want, it'll guarantee to make sure that all of our tenon cheeks are exactly at the same depth on both sides, on both ends, and on both pieces. And it's really, really easy to use, as you can see. In fact, once I get the first piece done, I mark it so that I know that that one's finished. I then flip it for the next one and I get started. One thing I will say when you're using your router plane is to avoid the potential of tear out on the back end, work towards the center. So as you can see, I work towards the center, I then flip it over, and this helps to make sure that there's no major tear out on the backside. Now, once you get it kind of established and you're removing just a small amount of material, it maybe is okay to kind of go through with a full length pass. But until then, I would just stick with working to the middle and then going from there. Now, another step that I kind of forgot to do, because it's been a while since I've done these hand cut mortise and tenons, is I want to not make a full width tenon. I actually only want a tenon that's about an inch deep and approximately about an inch wide. So what I'm doing now is I'm coming in and I'm marking for the material that I'm going to remove to make that much shorter, narrower tenon. And I just simply grab my dovetail saw and I start removing it, because this is technically a ripping cut. So I just go ahead and come in there and make that cut. Now, what I need to do is to establish a kerf so that I can remove the material from the side. But I want to be careful here. So rather than using the saw all the way through, I'm just kind of nipping it a little bit so I have a reference point. And then I'm going to come back in with my chisel. And as you can see here, I'm going to go ahead and start prying it away. One good thing about using the saw is that if there's any breakout, really, when it comes from this part right here, it's going to be hidden away inside the mortise and tenon joint itself. So that's where it's nice to use the saw to kind of get the exterior face kind of started. And then who really cares about the interior? It's going to be messed up a little bit. But still, as long as we do everything right, we'll get a really nice snug fit. Now, we're done with the tenon more or less, so it's time to actually work on the mortise. And when it comes to the mortise, again, I kind of go undersized. So I moved over to the drill press. I'm gonna remove some of the material using just a simple brad point drill bit. It'd be nice if I had a Forstner bit that was about this size, but we'll use the brad point drill bit to get most of our material removed. And we'll do this on both ends. Obviously, and then once we have that done, we'll go ahead and head back over to the workbench where we'll use our chisels to actually start cleaning it out and getting it snugged up to the right fit that we need. Back over at the workbench, as I mentioned, we'll go ahead and use our chisels. In this case, I need to be a little careful because number one, my chisel is a little bit thicker than the rough opening that I have here, so I want to make sure I'm not going to rip the piece open as I'm doing it. But I end up starting removing some of the sidewall stuff, the sidewall waste, so that I can get the tenon almost ready to go. I take my brad awl and I put that in there to start popping the waste material out. And it takes a little patience here, but once you get going, you can see the established line that you have. One thing I should say is that I used the tenon that we cut as my guide for how big the mortise needs to be. So I actually ended up holding the piece to the style, marked it out, and that's how I have my lines set up for this, so I know where to actually stop. And after just a few passes, we're ready to try it. And as you can see, it's a little snug, which is, it's more snug than we want at this point. But this is a good place to kind of work from. This is where we're going to keep working from there, just to remove just a little bit more material. And to be quite honest with you, after this, it only took a couple of passes and we were finished. So as you can see at this point, we're doing our first dry fit with the mortise and tenon. And we have it snug, but not tight, because if it's tight, then to be quite honest with you, we have the potential that it could split the actual mortise itself. But also, when we apply the glue, if it's too tight, as we're pushing the pieces together, the glue can be pushed away so that you're not even gonna get glue into the mortise, and that's obviously not what we want. So we want a nice snug fit, but not overly tight. And that's what we ended up getting by kind of sneaking up on that final size. Now, this is a good place to stop at this point. We're gonna go ahead and in next week's episode, we'll finish up the build itself. We'll be putting the detail on for the chamfer with the nice lamb's tongue on it. We'll also be adding the walnut plugs, and we'll end up going from there. Now, unfortunately, I don't have any footage of the finishing process, but I'll explain more about that next week. So if you have comments or questions about today's episode, or maybe something you would like to share, a suggestion for something that we did in here, I would love to hear from you. You can hold me at madsbasementworkshop@gmail.com, or of course you can stop by the website at madsbasementworkshop.com, where you can leave a comment in today's post. And of course, if you're watching this at YouTube, you can leave a comment over there also. Anyways, until the next episode, I'll be talking to all of you later. Straight grains and sharp blades. I look forward to hearing from all of you.